welcome everyone. I would like to say it's great to see the dialogue of sound with visual arts. And Clifton, as well as Joe, that have seen that sculpture a number of times at the studio. And for me, it's very crucial to associate the right music with a work of art. For instance, if you associate too much the music of Debussy with the water lilies, it's not a good service for the water lilies. The water lilies are much more sexual than La Mer de Debussy, for instance. So it's quite crucial when an artist is alive is to try to have the right association between the arts. So thank you tonight for that, Joe McPhee and Clifton Hyde.
Does that mean Monet wanted Ravel to write his stuff?
I wrote in the notes, Alain asked me to say a few words about what this might be. And I thought about it, and I remember, I think, if the dates are correct, sometime in 1968, I saw an advertisement someplace that Ornette Coleman was going to be playing. I don't remember exactly where it was, but it was Forms and Sounds. There's a recording on RCA Victor Red Seal label, which was very rare, to have someone playing jazz, if that's what we want to call it, on the RCA Red Seal label. And here was Ornette playing with this ensemble. He played interludes, and he played actually interludes on trumpet. I came down from upstate New York. I live in Poughkeepsie, New York, and a friend of mine, whose name is Tyrone Crabb, bass player who played in the band that I played in, had a TR4 car with no heat. It was a convertible, and we froze our asses off coming to that concert. And you probably can't find that recording anywhere now, if the LP. There is one CD that I saw somewhere, so if you could hear it, it would give you some idea of what we're drawing this from. Forms and sounds, and I took from that, trying to extrapolate from that concept, new forms. Ooh, listen to that.
Yeah, I was just thinking, shit, I might not play guitar tonight.
Ooh, speaks on its own. And new sounds. Well, we'll discover some, certainly because I came down from the north again tonight. Yeah. From Poughkeepsie in the rainstorm and the Mets can't play. That's too bad. But be that as it may, we're going to do the best we can, and we hope that we can touch these forms. I would invite you to close your eyes. Don't look at us, because we're not that interesting. But the sounds will bounce off of these things, bounce off of the room, bounce off of the people who preceded us, bounce off of the giants upon whose shoulders we stand, those giants who made it possible for us to attempt to do the kind of music that we do, and without further bullshit.
Thank you.
quality.
Thank you.
Take a short pause and I'm going to find out what's stuck in my horn. Thank you. Take a short pause, thank you. As I'm thinking here in the rain, and I'll wait till everyone's settled, kind of. As everyone, did we scare enough people away?
It was that satin doll in the middle that really fucked
yeah. me. Brave souls that you are for staying for this. Let us not forget, because I haven't seen anything, and I don't know if anything was ever done about Dewey Redman, but to just for a moment to remember Dewey, who was not only a marvelous saxophonist, but a great human being, and someone who I sort of put into my music, the kind of singing into the instrument on top of whatever else is going on absolutely definitely comes from Dewey. I don't know, I think when I first heard him do this kind of thing, it just woke me up and I thought, wow, is that possible? I don't know how anybody could do that. And I try to incorporate it into a lot of different things that I do, sometimes into the saxophone, sometimes into the trumpet, or whatever. But anyway, all of that only comes from Dewey Redman. And I remember in 1992, I ran into him in a little place in Austria. And he arrived early in the morning with his son Joshua. And Joshua had never been to Europe before. And he was a little jet lagged and everything. Dewey was not. Dewey sang the blues and he played his ass off. And he introduced Joshua to the whole scene, what was going on. After that, Joshua ended up on the cover of GQ, very handsome young guy, and certainly deserving of everything that he's gotten in these times. But people forget that Dewey, with Ornette, what he did, and the importance of this man. And now he's gone, he died a month or so ago, and I haven't heard anything about a memorial, and I think that's just absolutely Dewey. He wouldn't have it any other way. But we keep him, and we remember him, and I hope you guys do too. So. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
guess that's the story, and that's, we're sticking to it.
There you
that's
go.
All there is. Thank you very much. Thank you so much.
Congrats. I would like to thank Joe McPhee and Clifton Hyde to have contribute to something rather rare, is to have this dialogue between visual art and music, and it seems to be so important. And tonight we have a sculpture into a context of a program of music, and I always strive to bring music into the context of museums and galleries. So it's really something we really need, and I want, of course, to thank both musicians, but also the trombonist, Jim Staley, that is the great... Thank you, Jim. Not only Jim is an artist, a musician, but he does the program. He does the program.
Also,
yeah, I will finish just also.
Okay. We don't want to forget.
Yes.
The engineer on the board.
Okay.
What's your name again? I don't.
Cyrus.
Okay.
I thank you.
It's like Cyprus without the P.
But I just wanted to say that it's extremely rare and difficult to be an artist and at the same time to run a program. So it's for so many years. So thank you, Jim, for you. Yeah.
And of course, we really want to thank you, because without you, we would have a very difficult time indeed. And it's very important to understand that what we do, it's not only difficult, it's a bit dangerous, especially in these times, in these political times, when there's so much crap going on out here, so many lies and bullshit. You've got to be able to decipher, you've got to decide for yourself what's real and what's not real, what you like and what you don't like. And also, listening is not a passive experience. What we do up here is hard enough for us, but it's hard for you too. It's an active experience. You've got to participate, and you've got to be as creative in your listening experience as we try to be in what we try to bring to you. And we really appreciate your being here. We can feel you. We know what's happening. Believe it.